Okay, colleagues, the next item of business is a statement by Hamza Youssef on the independent review of Moray maternity services. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Hamza Youssef for around 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be able to update Parliament and members on the action that will be taken following the publication of the independent review of maternity services in Moray, and namely our next steps for the reintroduction of consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's Hospital in Elgin. I'm currently considering the 37 recommendations in greater detail, and I want to take the time to do this, primarily in discussions with NHS Grampian, NHS Highland, but importantly local people, the local community, including of course elected representatives. At this stage, it's important to say that the government hasn't ruled out any of the options presented. Members will be aware that I've been committed to the reinstatement of consultant-led maternity services in a safe and sustainable way. That's a commitment that was reiterated as part of our manifesto, and members will recall the members' debate from Douglas Ross on this very topic back in June. I very much welcome this much anticipated report. In particular, I welcome the thorough and consultative approach that the review team took. I met with Rafe Roberts, the Chief Executive of NHS Borders, who led the review on Friday. He told me that around 300 individuals contributed their views, and the team held nearly 50 evidence sessions, and the outputs of these discussions excuse me, are very evident throughout the report. I would like to give my thanks to Mr. Roberts, to the review team for the thorough and substantial report that they have produced. I'd also like to thank the members of staff of, and professionals from across NHS Grampian, NHS Highland and the wider Scottish Health Service for their contributions. In particular, and most importantly, as I say, I'd like to thank people, the local people, local representatives, of course, as well, but most importantly, the women, the families who have shared their views and their own experiences. Without them, this report would not have been possible. It certainly wouldn't have been as impactful and as powerful. This afternoon, I will speak to the report, but I'm keen not to preempt any final decisions that I will make in this regard. And I will then say a bit more about the immediate actions that have already begun, and then of course I will touch upon the medium and long term issues which I know are of great importance. I'm heartened, I have to say, by the response to the report thus far, with both NHS Grampian and Highland welcoming the report and signalling their intention to work together and with the Scottish Government to work through the challenges for any implementation of the recommendations. Keep Mum, who led the campaign and continue to lead the campaign for maternity services, have also responded, I think, very fairly and positively. They welcomed that the voices of women and their families have been heard in the report. I know that people need to have time, of course, to digest and consider the findings, and that, of course, they are waiting for a strong signal from government about the next steps and, indeed, implementation. When we appointed Rafe Roberts to chair the review in March of this year, we asked the review team to work with NHS Grampian, with NHS Highland, and stakeholders with an interest in local maternity services to explore the best obstetric model that will provide safe, deliverable, sustainable and indeed a high-quality maternity service for the women and families of Moray, in line with the Scottish Government's ambition that's described in the Best Start, a five-year plan for maternity and neonatal care. For those who have had the opportunity to read this extensive report, I'm sure you will agree that it is comprehensive, but it's also very grounded and very pragmatic and realistic. This is not the first report, of course, I know, into maternity services at Dr. Gray's in recent years, and that is very important moving forward. We acknowledge the work that's already underway in NHS Grampian, again through the Best Start North programme, to look at maternity services across the whole of the north of Scotland. As I say, what I'd like to do this afternoon is set out how we intend to move forward with the immediate and short term, but also I will touch upon, of course, the medium and long term as well. The report itself does set out a preferred approach that has a detailed plan on how this could be taken forward, but the report also has a number of supporting recommendations, namely on existing service provision. The report highlights actions that will support the safe reintroduction of elective C-sections at Dr. Gray's. On culture, it talks of a cross-site working for staff and the commissioning of a cultural safety programme. It demands leadership from not just the board but also from the Scottish Government on workforce and recruitment, which we know is absolutely key and has been a challenge to sustainability in the long term. It makes important recommendations, and I should say that we're already making inroads through our implementation of the Best Start, our forward plan for maternity and neonatal services, but clearly I recognise further work here absolutely remains. And finally, on infrastructure, I'd like to commit here and today we will work closely with both NHS Grampian and Highland to secure the future of Dr Gray's Hospital, and will invest in its future development in whatever form that takes. I want to pause just for a moment to reflect on the fact that NHS staff in maternity and neonatal services, like all our NHS staff of course, have continued to provide high quality maternity and neonatal services each and every day for the last 20 months. I want to pay tribute to their ongoing hard work and thank them for their dedication, their resilience and determination in the face of a global pandemic. And moving on to the immediate actions we intend to take in relation to maternity services at Dr Gray's, I was able to meet with both NHS Grampian and Highland briefly this morning, and they've expressed to me certainly their determination and commitment to take forward the recommendations in the review. I have made arrangements to travel to Moray in less than a fortnight, on the 20th of December, to meet with local people, including local campaign groups such as Keep Mum, clinicians and elected representatives, and the health boards, again, to discuss the report recommendations with them. My office, if it has not already sent out invitations, will be sending out invitations to interested parties by the close of play today. And Douglas Ross does tell me, actually, that that date is also his wife Crystal's birthday. I'm sure she'll be delighted that he has chosen to spend it with me as opposed to her. We will work at pace with NHS Grampian to look at what is possible in the short term, including the rapid reintroduction of elective caesarean sections. This will quickly double the number of women who can deliver at Dr Gray's up to 40%, around 400 births per year. But of course, I've heard the comments from my colleagues, including Richard Lockhead, who members will not be surprised continually and often asks me and brings forward issues around Dr Gray's, that still means that the majority of women will not be giving birth in Moray, and therefore we have to look at the medium and the long term, which I know is an issue again that was raised in the parliamentary debate here in June. These discussions obviously will have to include NHS Highland also, recognising the report highlights the critical role of Raig Mór, a choice for women to deliver their babies when the maternity unit has been improved and expanded. But I want to be clear, for this to be sustainable, there are a number of relevant actions that first need to take place. I know we have previously tried to implement this model, but it quickly became unsustainable, quickly became undone, and I'm determined to ensure that we have the relevant infrastructure to support change prior to any implementation. Which brings me on to the medium and longer term recommendations in the report, particularly Model 5, the development of a midwife-led consultant-supported unit that would be located in Dr Gray's Hospital in Elgin. This is an option that I was pleased to see was supported by the Keep Mum campaign group in their recent response to the report. Under this model, consultant-supported births, including emergency C-sections and instrumental deliveries, would allow up to 70% of Moray women to deliver their babies in the local community. The report highlights some of the challenges and preconditions for this model, and they can't be ignored. This model is set within the wider context of a vision for future development of Dr Gray's, which will require a clear strategic plan for the hospital, and serious practical and financial consideration will need to be worked through to support such a change. This brings me back to the commitment to reinstate consultant-led maternity in a safe and sustainable way. We want to deliver this commitment quickly, safely and sustainably, and I fully expect that Models 4 and 5 will allow us to return to consultant maternity services to Dr Gray's in such a way. But we will have to do that, not without a shadow of a doubt, in concert and consultation with the local community, with the local clinicians, and indeed with local representatives and the health boards. But it will have to be done in a way that is open and transparent from the government about the challenges, but I hope that the community will see that we will also work on that with pace. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, I could talk at length on the report, given how extensive it is, but my focus now, as I've said, is to meet with local people to discuss the findings and get on with this action. So I give them an absolute commitment that we will not waste any time, or there will not be a lack of pace or urgency in relation to taking forward and driving forward our work to restore consultant-led maternity services. Dr. Grace.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow 20 minutes, after which we will have to move on to the next item of business. And as ever, any members wishing to ask a question should press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function. And I start by calling Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I also want to acknowledge the work of Rafe Roberts and his review team. But in particular, I want to thank the women and the families and the staff in Moray who shared their experiences. The staff at both Dr. Gray's and Aberdeen, I know through personal experience, are the very best we could hope for in our area. And throughout the report, they are rightly commended by everyone for everything they do. First and foremost, though, the review said the status quo was promptly considered to be inappropriate. It goes on to say about the current model that both Professor Cameron in his report and the review group believe there are potential risks to patient safety. So I have to ask the Cabinet Secretary, why have we been living with this model in Moray now for over 3 years? Can I also ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he believe the staffing and capacity can be found at Raigmoor to take hundreds of additional women from Moray each year, given that the numbers transferred to Inverness has actually fallen every year since our maternity unit was downgraded and was just 16 last year? I welcome that elective caesareans will return, but does the Cabinet Secretary believe that induction of labour at Dr. Gray's should also be made available if possible? And finally, will an action plan with key milestones be provided once he's looked through the recommendations so everyone locally can keep up to date with the progress or otherwise being made? And Deputy Presiding Officer, I just wanted to finish by saying my hope is for as many women in Moray to give birth locally. As a family, we're blessed with two great boys, but they were both born in very different circumstances. Alistair came into this world at Dr. Gray's, and after a few days of great care and support, we travelled just a few miles home with our newborn. But with James, it was a different scenario. As Crystal's labour progressed, his heart rate started to dip every time she had contractions. And for someone to be on a green pathway right up to that point, it rocked me to hear that. I tried to be strong for her because I knew it was stressful for Crystal as well. To then see your wife taken in a trolley through hospital, strapped into the back of an ambulance, and then taken through to Aberdeen, it was one of the worst experiences I've ever faced. And at that moment, you feel utterly helpless at the time your wife and unborn child need you most. And I just say this because whether it's 40 miles to Inverness or 65 miles to Aberdeen, that journey adds stress, anxiety and worry at an already emotional time. So I just hope across Parliament we can agree to do everything possible to maximise the number of women able to give birth in Moray and do everything possible to minimise those who have to leave our area to have their children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Ross. Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Douglas Ross for his questions, and can I speak to him first as a father as opposed to as the Health Secretary, that I would have hated to be in the position that he was in. When my wife gave birth to our daughter Amal, she was already in a high-risk pathway. We'd unfortunately miscarried a number of times before that, and my daughter was transverse and therefore not in the right position. And she decided just for fun to arrive 3 weeks early as well. But we were only 20 minutes away from the hospital that we had to be at. But I recognise his feelings and emotions around being helpless, let alone having to drive for the period of time in the back of an ambulance that his wife had to be transported in the back of an ambulance like his wife, Crystal, had to be. So as a father, as opposed to the Health Secretary, let me say just how unacceptable I find that entire situation. Because that is the question Douglas Ross asked me. He said, do I find it acceptable that we've had this model for the last 3 years. I don't find it acceptable. He's right to, on behalf of his constituents, be upset, angry and frustrated. And that's why I say that I have no issues with him characterising that and the current situation in that way. It's why I've also been impressed, I have to say, by the cross-party campaign that has been there. As I say, my colleague Richard Lockhead, you can imagine, was one of the first to phone me on Friday when the report was published to understand and to put his concerns as a local MSP, not as a government minister, but as a local MSP, put the concerns of his constituents forward to me. Douglas Ross has done exceptionally well to raise this issue in our parliament, and I want to pay my tribute to that cross-party campaign. On the specific questions about Raigmore, I asked that very question to Pam Dudek, to Boyd Robertson, the team at NHS Highland, and he will know that Raigmore is going under significant development, and we have promised to invest in that development. So I absolutely believe that the additional women who may have to go to Raigmore, that there is the capacity to be able to deal with that. But I will give him further assurances in and around that. His question about induction-led labour, what I would say is it's really important for me to be able to go up to Moray, to go into Dr. Gray's and to be able to speak to the clinicians. I am not a clinician, and therefore it is not for me to be able to say what can be done safely. What I want to be able to say to Douglas Ross and to the community that's watching, we want that consultant-led maternity service there in Dr. Gray's. We want as many women as safe as possible to give birth at Dr. Gray's. We will do that with urgency and pace, but we also have to recognise the significant workforce challenges that exist. And that's why I think Douglas Ross's last point, which I'll end on, Presiding Officer, is really important, that there has to be an implementation plan, clear milestones. But I'll be upfront and realistic about that. Members might not always like the timescales, and they might challenge us and tell us to go even faster, and that's their prerogative, and so may the local community. But I'll be really upfront about the milestones and the implementation. So the next stages are visit Moray, speak to local community, local clinicians, elected representatives, and then I would hope early in the new year come forward with further detail of the recommendations we're taking forward and an implementation plan to follow.
Thank you, and I call Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the statement from the Minister, and it's positive to see progress on this issue. Progress led indeed by Ralph Roberts, the Chief Executive of NHS Borders from my own region, and I thank him and the review team for their work alongside the hard work of local campaign groups who have pushed this issue forward. Excuse me. Despite the progress detailed in the statement, Minister, can you offer some clarity about what will be done to solve the underlying issues, which is, as is in many other parts of the country, a lack of staff? There are 365 whole-time equivalent nurse and midwifery vacancies in NHS Highland and 465 such vacancies in NHS Grampian. There is, on top of this, a known lack of paediatricians. The statement today barely addresses this. What can be done about this?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a fair challenge. It goes to the crux of the issue that NHS Grampian Highland spoke to me about today. But plans are underway by the Health Board already to increase recruitment in both health boards. But that is the crux of the issue, and it's why I have to be realistic. It would have been unrealistic of Ralph Roberts' report to suggest that Model 5 could be implemented within a few months or even within a year, because there's no way you'd be able to get the workforce to be able to do that. There's also infrastructure issues, of course, with that model that we have to develop. So I can give Carol Mochan an absolute assurance, and also to the campaigners who I know I'm certain will be watching today's statement, that we understand that workforce and the infrastructure of the hospital are two key issues that we have to demonstrate not just progress on, but investment in, and I've already given a commitment that we will invest in both those aspects.
Karen Adam, to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for this, bringing forward this comprehensive report. But firstly, I really want to thank the people that have came forward with lived experience and shared those experiences, which must have been quite distressing for them, but have pushed for action on this. And I'm also glad to hear that there will be ongoing conversations with them. My question is actually a reflection of Carl Mochen's, and it was really, you know, asking the Cabinet Secretary to outline the action that Scottish Government has taken to increase the number of appropriately trained clinical staff. As he's answered there in part, I was just wondering, will this also be, you know, in terms of including Dr. Gray's, but as well as other rural healthcare centres? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, in short, yes, and I know there's a number of issues that have been raised by members right across the country, particularly in remote, rural and island areas about workforce retention, recruitment actually, and retention. And therefore, we're working with those health boards. We understand the unique challenges that are there, and already we have seen in some aspects an increase in the workforce, but on this particular issue and around Dr. Gray's, we've got to tackle that workforce challenge that is the crux of this issue, as well as the infrastructure, which is a slightly easier part. We can invest in infrastructure and build and so on, but the workforce challenge is far more difficult, and that's why we've got to make sure that there's a sustained effort for consultant-led maternity services in Moray.
Edward Mountain, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the preferred options for Moray is for a midwife-led service like Caithness has. The result in Caithness is less babies than ever before have been born there, with only about 20 to 30% of all far north births happening in Caithness. So, Cabinet Secretary, what work will the Scottish Government commission to assess if NHS Highland can truly take on the additional work without disadvantaging their catchment patients, and what the additional costs will be, and who will fund these?
Cabinet Secretary.
So it's all part of the discussions that are taking place. I did, in my discussions with Ralph Roberts on Friday, he did say to me that there's no doubt that people will make comparisons to the situation in Caithness and what's happening in Dr. Gray's, and I can understand why that is done, or why the interdependency and interactions are mentioned. What I would say is we are talking about two different scenarios, but in terms of the impact that the models and recommendations in Ralph Roberts' review, what impact they would have in other rural health settings, I think is a very fair question for Edward Mountain to ask, and I promise him that our conversations will be focused not just on Dr. Gray's, but also on some of the other rural health sites that may well potentially be impacted by any decisions that are made by, in relation to this review. So I'm more than happy if he wishes to be part of the conversations in this regard to take forward those discussions with Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Gillian Martin, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's very welcome that the independent review focused on listening to the women, families and service users in Moray, as well as the staff involved in delivering the services. Cabinet Secretary has outlined some of the steps the Scottish Government has taken to ensure continued stakeholder engagement. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that mothers in rural areas must have the choice of having their maternity care close to where they live for so many reasons, not least their mental health? And can he give me assurances that their views will continue to be taken into account as decisions are made going forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, yes, I do fundamentally agree with that point, and I spoke in my response to Douglas Ross just my own experience of that. And you know, I was very lucky and very blessed that I had the hospital where my wife gave birth was, as I say, literally 15-20 minutes away from our own home. It is a fundamental recommendation of the Best Start policy that women have care delivered as close to home as possible. But of course, that has to be balanced. I know every member understands this, but it has to be balanced in relation to the safety of both the mother and the baby as well. And the introduction of Near Me across the NHS has allowed many women to access care in the local area when they may have previously had to travel to big urban centres. In addition, the development of community hubs and community teams under Best Start will provide as much antenatal and postnatal care in the community as possible. But ultimately, of course, Gillian Martin is right. Having that care, being able to deliver your baby, give birth as close to home as possible, is certainly an ambition of this government.
Next two colleagues join us remotely. Firstly, Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome the review, but feel for families who are rightly frustrated by delays. Therefore, it would be good to have a clear indication of the timeframe for the restoration of full maternity services. Dr. Grays? And in the meantime, what support is available to families who have to travel to Aberdeen or Inverness for maternity services by way of accommodation and by way of child minding for their families?
Cabinet Secretary.
These are all very, very fair points. For me, I completely accept the desire of the local community and other stakeholders that have an interest in this matter to see a detailed implementation plan from the government. So we will do that. As I've said a number of times in this chamber already, in the first instance, I'd like to meet with the local community, and that includes local representatives. And if I haven't invited you and you're a local elected member and you'd like to be part of the discussions, please get in touch with my office. I have no issues with inviting whoever to that conversation. Then, of course, we will give detail of the recommendations we are seeking to take forward. And then, of course, alongside that, we would look to plan, bring forward an implementation plan with key milestones. And Ralph Robertson has reviewed, goes into the detail of that, of those timescales he thinks would be involved. You can imagine, as Cabinet Secretary for Health, I want to try to push those as much as I can with pace. So I will ensure, on Rhoda Grant's second point around what support is available for women and families who may have to travel to Aberdeen or to Raigmore. I will look into that. If we can do anything further on that, I'd be very open to that. I think, again, it's a fair request, particularly if there's accommodation costs as well as travel costs that are involved. So I could look into that matter offline.
Thank you. We've got 5 minutes and five speakers, so I think succinct questions and responses as far as possible. First, Emma Roddick, to be followed by Ali-Anne Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The delivery of these recommendations within the timescale set out will, of course, take time and, critically, dedication by all those involved. So can the Cabinet Secretary give an update on discussions with NHS Grampian to ensure that the board has a full leadership team in place in a timely manner?
Cabinet Secretary.
To be brief, I had a discussion with the Health Board this morning. I'll meet with them again, as you'd imagine, on the 20th of December as well. But I can assure Emma Roddick that the points that she raises are very much part of the discussion that we're having. And, of course, the Health Board's input into this will be of vital importance as we progress these actions.
Thank you. Ali-Anne Burgess, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
The independent review found that maternity services are key to the wider economic and community well-being of the population, so it is vital that Dr. Grays Hospital is supported to improve its ability to provide high-quality maternity care for local families in Moray. This review is not the first. The 2019 Alan Cameron report found that working relationships in the Dr. Grays maternity service were dysfunctional and damaged to the extent that they may impact upon patient safety. I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary whether the Scottish Government is supporting Dr. Grays to implement the recommendations from that review, particularly the recommendation to develop a full package of support for all staff who have been adversely affected by the issues within the Dr. Grays maternity service, so that these recommendations do not get lost as work to implement the new recommendations begins.
Yes, in short, we will not ignore previous recommendations, but I would say, and I'm sure Ms. Burgess has done this, but there's a fair bit of detail on culture within Ralph Roberts' report, and of course we'll take forward those recommendations too.
Thank you. Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the course of the pandemic, we've seen the benefits that services such as Near Me, that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned a short time ago, can deliver to reduce the need for in-person appointments. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what role he envisages such technology may have in the delivery of services in Moray going forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Just to be brief, and as part of my previous answer, an answer to a previous question, I mentioned Near Me. I do think technology absolutely has a role to play in possible antenatal care, postnatal care as well. But that doesn't detract, and we should be very clear about this, doesn't detract from the desire of women, families, the local community to give birth as close to home as possible. So technology is absolutely a great enabler, but of course we that does not take away from the desire of women and families to give birth as close to home as possible, which is what we want to progress through this report.
Jamie Halker-Johnson, to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
In the interest of brevity, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, given the number of patient transfers that have had to be conducted, sometimes on short notice, to either Raigmore or Aberdeen, what impact does he think the ongoing problems have had on an already overstretched ambulance service in the Highlands and Islands?
Exemplary. Cabinet Secretary.
I suspect it does not help, which is the obvious answer that I would give to Jamie Halkett-Johnson. So certainly this is part of our consideration about how quickly we can ensure more births take place at Dr Gray's and indeed closer to home as possible for people, whether they're in island communities or in remote and rural communities too.
Thank you. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A section of the recommendation references the importance of culture to quality and safety in any service, and this is not only beneficial to service users, but also of equal importance to staff. Can the Cabinet Secretary give an indication of the work that will be required to progress the delivery of a cultural safety programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
In the interest of brevity, I'm probably better writing to Stephanie Callaghan with the detail of that, but what I would say is she's right to highlight this. As I said in my response to Ms Burgess, that the extensive report from Rafe Roberts goes into the importance of culture in the workplace, which I think is a vitally important part. So we can focus often on the clinical expertise and the infrastructure that is needed to deliver the recommendations within the review. But what I would say is culture of the workforce and cultural safety, and that's one of the recommendations from Rafe Roberts, is to invest in cultural safety as a programme, is certainly a vital part of his report, which I intend to take forward.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes this item of business. There will be a short pause before we start the next item.